Hi, welcome to Harvard Business Review's The New World of Work. I'm Adi Ignatius, editor-in-chief of Harvard Business Review. And each week on the show, we speak to a top-tier CEO about this transition moment that we're in to sort of get ideas and inspiration about how we can work more effectively going forward. Before I introduce my guest this week, I just want to quickly read a message from our friends at Unisys, sponsor of The New World of Work. Unisys is an IT company that builds critical solutions trusted by demanding businesses and governments around the world. They partner with clients to enable cloud transformation, protect critical operations, and empower the modern workforce. Visit unisys.com to learn more. So my guest today is Roz Brewer, the CEO of Walgreens Boots Alliance. She has a very impressive resume. Before becoming CEO of Walgreens, she served as COO of Starbucks, and before that, as CEO of Sam's Club. In her first half year or so at Walgreens, she started to lay down a strategic rethink that we will talk about later. She also has been an outspoken advocate throughout her career for diversity and inclusion issues. So, Roz, welcome to the show, and thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Let me just tell our audience, if you have questions for Roz, please put them in the comments box, and we'll try to get to some of those later in the show. So, Roz, let's start with your career. You have had a series of top jobs, as I said, at Sam's Club, at Starbucks, now at Walgreens Boots Alliance. Talk about the challenges of walking into a new company, you know, a new industry in some cases, and projecting the kind of confidence that you need to do, you know, that you need to be able to do your job from day one.
Great. That's a very good question, especially now. Having walked into, a healthcare company in the middle of the pandemic. And I think that was a pretty gutsy move, and every day it's proven to be true. But I will tell you that I have been fortunate to really accumulate so many different learnings over my career. And I'm pretty adamant about making sure that I am clear about my role, what my intent is, and how do I bring together my toolbox. I think the one thread that I can pull through all of my roles and opportunities is my personal leadership. And that's the way I show up first and foremost, because most of these business problems that I face in these leadership roles, it takes character, it takes guts, it takes problem solving. And when I bring that basic toolkit to bear in these different roles, it has been proven effective for me every time. So I think the other thing I will tell you is that whenever I take on a new role, I become a real student of the business. I remember when I joined Walmart after being with Kimberly-Clark for such a long time and being in consumer products and going into retail. And I decided to, my job was based in Atlanta, Georgia, but I decided to move myself to Bentonville, Arkansas and go on a learning journey for 90 days. And I stayed in a little small hotel and came into the home office there and really studied them during what I call the honeymoon period. And it was the best thing I could have ever done. I met people, I learned more about retail, and I really put myself in a learning position and not in a position initially of leadership. And I chose to learn and be an advocate and open-minded about what the opportunities were ahead of me.
Yep. That's great. So I want to ask you, so you are, as a Fortune 500 CEO, you are in a very elite group. As a Black female CEO in that group, you are truly in rarefied territory. So, mm-hmm. How do you balance the pressure, the scrutiny, the expectations that accompany, being, practically the only person like yourself in these fields?
I will tell you, it's sometimes, you can feel like, it's a lonely position, because you don't see yourself in different environments that you're in. And then I look at myself personally and say, what can I do to change this? Because, it could be difficult at certain times. What I will tell you, though, is I think that the environment is opening up more to people recognizing the differences and appreciating the differences. Many times, I am called upon and asked to give my opinion on diversity issues. And I will be honest with you, I am as frank as I possibly can be, because I do think I hold a unique position. So when I get in these settings, I take advantage of an opportunity to learn and educate those around me, because I can feel it when they're unfamiliar with me or my culture. I don't hide my culture. I talk about it very openly. I feel like that is almost my second reason for being. You know, everybody has their purpose in how you get into a situation or environment, but I take advantage of it and do everything I can to teach and expose people to my culture and who I am. I learned probably sort of early in my career, I'd say maybe 5 to 7 years out of college, that I really wanted to bring my whole self to work. So I don't cover up my culture at all. And I think that that's helpful for me because they know how to count on me and what the expectations are in terms of interacting with me.
So I'm guessing that throughout your career, you've often been, you know, the only woman, maybe the only person of color in a room full of executives. I mean, you talked about bringing yourself, but can you talk a little bit more about, you know, how do you manage that situation and how do you make it work?
Yes. You know, I really do look forward to the day where I'm not really the only in these rooms and environments, and I'm doing a lot personally to try and make that happen. I will tell you the, you know, the way I deal with this is, you know, really, I'm actually no different than other individuals in the room, and I try and share that as well. My accomplishments come from hard work, come from exposure. One of the things I find myself doing, fortunate or unfortunately, is sometimes I have to run a few people through my resume, because I think they look at my titles and say, ah, did she really do the work? How did she get there? But I have some absolute real lived experiences. You know, when I was at Starbucks, I've worked the drive-through window. When I was at Walmart, I threw trucks at night so I could learn distribution, logistics, warehousing at those companies. So I've done the worst and the best of the jobs. Sometimes I have to remind people of that. And it gives me credibility that I've not been a token. I've not been granted these jobs. I've absolutely had to work very hard to get where I am. And so I find myself doing that. But, you know, it doesn't bother me. I'm hoping, I'm an optimist and hope that that is not what the next person has to do. But for now, I find myself having to really go in a deep dive in terms of my experience and do a lot of storytelling about why I believe in what I believe in. And, you know, I get in a situation, you know, I'm on the business roundtable and we're getting into some really courageous conversations around the new infrastructure bill. Well, you know, I happen to have a lot of experience in the space of what it takes to move goods across the United States. And, you know, I've been fortunate enough to maybe share a little bit of that. And maybe people didn't realize that I had a background in that as well, because you can't be in retail and not understand supply chain and logistics.
So we actually we're getting some questions from our viewers, and some of them were about, okay, how do you, you know, actively learn about a new business? And you really sort of answered that, and sort of jumping in, you know, at the bottom in some cases. Let's talk more broadly about workplace diversity. Sure. You know, in a more general sense. You know, as you know, the corporate world, we're all trying to move the needle on diversity, equity, and inclusion. And that has been an imperative since the murder of George Floyd. You know, wish it didn't have to be because of that, but that's where we are. What's your view on how companies can pursue a DEI strategy that truly has meaning?
Yes. So, you know, it's interesting. When the George Floyd incident happened, I actually thought I knew it all and I had been doing a good job in DE&I. And I quickly realized that even myself, who's been a huge proponent of it, myself who, you know, I'm a double minority, you know, myself, a mother of, you know, a young Black male, I thought I understood this, but I realized that I didn't. I realized that I had not been asking all the right questions. I had not been focusing on the parts of our environment and our social environment that are very much broken. I think myself included, you know, we have been focusing on the D of DE&I and not equity and not inclusion. And I say that because What really happened with the George Floyd incident is that I don't think people understood, the race issues that are happening in our country, those that are left out and those who don't see a way out of their current situation. But we do see putting numbers in place and hiring numbers. But have we asked the questions, how can someone survive off of minimum wage? And where is our country on great education and access to healthcare? And also too, it made me think back. I took it personally when all of that was happening. As you can imagine, I didn't know George Floyd, and not many of us did. But I tried to put myself in the shoes of him and of his family. And I think about the work that, I was doing at Walmart. I was just so adamant about, just clearing the way and thinking about how can I close in on food deserts, right? If people have proper food and access to the best price, the best cost in food. So, I did everything I could do to put Walmart stores in the right zip codes. And then when I realized that you can do that, but, in providing food for early education so people can come to school and learn and engage, that was my focus. But was I listening to take it one level lower, Roz, is what I said to myself and say, so if you put the food right near them and they're still not, proper nutrition and, proper healthcare in those places, what's causing them from not being able to thrive, right? And get and rise above the minimum wage job and go to the next level and the next level, because that's the history that we know in the United States, is to give someone their start and then they take it to the next level. And that's because we haven't done enough work to study and think about, what happens in someone's life when, you're single parenting more than one child and you've got to care for that child. And, it's more than cost. It's about their self-esteem. And so we begin to look at things like, how do you feel about yourself? And are we developing that in people? And so I came back at that time when George Floyd's situation was happening. I was with Starbucks. And we began to do work on providing mental health access for communities, for all of our employees, actually, and making that accessible, right? We began to think about what does it mean to really teach and train someone? Are you giving them training materials? Are you teaching them how to learn? And recognizing that people learn differently, right? And so for me, that whole situation said that we've been putting numbers on the board from a diversity standpoint, but we're not creating equity. And then there's a piece around inclusion. And I would tell you from an inclusive standpoint, we have not created environments where people feel like they can bring their whole self to their opportunities in front of them. We don't recognize from where they've come from and give them the same, fair chance and give them an environment where they feel listened to and seen. And we don't do that. We hadn't been doing that well. And so I, at Starbucks, a group of us, the leadership team, we made it our business to make sure that when we are in stores, we are talking to people and not talking at people. And we're doing more listening than talking. And I had already had the practice of never walk into a retail unit as a leader and have your mobile device out. I never do that. I either leave it in my automobile or put it in my pocket because I need to be present. I need to listen. But that wasn't enough. I was listening and I wasn't acting and I wasn't drilling down enough. And I think that's the next level of leadership, is that we're going to have to get pretty gritty about listening and acting and making people feel included in the environments that we create as leaders.
So the first takeaway is, leaders, leave your phones in your pockets. Let me follow up on that. It seems that even when there is diverse representation, that corporate cultures can produce a kind of group think and group speak. So how do you, how do you create teams and including, top level executive teams that are not only diverse, on paper, but truly reflect the kind of diversity of viewpoints that trace to, varied experiences and backgrounds?
Yes. One of the things that I think about when I'm thinking about diversity is diversity of thought, because, we can also, realize too that, there are individuals who may not be diverse of diverse culture, race, or gender themselves, but where is their mindset? How do they think about different cultures and different environments? One of the things that I began to do in my career is to put agile teams together. And what I mean by that is a lot of times, you know, you have your finance team working in their silo, you'll have the tech team working in their silo, but what I really think works is when we create these agile teams and put them against the biggest problems to solve. That's one of the things I'm doing right now at Walgreens Boots Alliance, is to make sure that this organization understands what are the biggest problems that we're going to solve. It's not, do we have enough technology, but is the technology fulfilling the need for efficiencies in the organization? Is it creating the right tools for our team members at store level and for our customers? So, to give you an example, you know, you can have the best strategy in the world, but if your team operates in an environment where they're all in a silo-driven, you know, environment, you're not going to get the results that you expect. So, for instance, you know, right now we're trying to create a tech-enabled healthcare company. I'm saying this, I have the same message for the entire group. And the biggest problem to solve is that how do we become the best performing stock in the Dow? And so when you put that team together, you're forcing finance and technology and operations and manufacturing all to be, you know, in the same room, in the same discussion against the biggest problem to solve. And it's not finance solving a finance problem. And I think what that actually does is it gets the diversity of thought to happen. And then you have different people sitting around the table. And in some cases, one of the outcomes that I've seen is that in certain functions, we have heavier opportunity for diversity than we do in others. I would love to see more diversity in technology. It's coming. But right now I have a lot of diversity in finance. So I get the opportunity to put a diverse financial team to a growing diverse tech team in the room. So diversity of thought is happening around the problem to solve. And then the cultures are coming together. And hopefully we'll move all of those opportunities up. But it's about creating these agile teams and putting them against, the unique problems to solve and forcing them to relate to each other and think about how to solve it. Now, you may say, well, where does race and gender come into that? It absolutely happens, because if you don't have people who don't have the innate ability to be forced to think different about a problem to solve, they absolutely are not going to get there on a discussion with race and gender. So you have to start where people are. People operate in their functions. Start where they are and move them to where you want the organization to go to. It proved successful for me at Starbucks. I'm replicating it again at WBA.
That's a really interesting approach. So you mentioned culture. I read the transcript of your recent earnings call, and you talked about the importance of culture in driving corporate results. I'm interested in your thoughts on how institutions can, create and sustain culture effectively when we're now so distributed, and where yes. employees want to be even more distributed than we've tolerated or whatever that we've accepted in the past. It seems to be one of the biggest challenges right now for every institution.
It is super complicated, I've done all the right things. You know, how many Zoom calls can I have? How many times can I have dinner on a Zoom call, happy hour, you know, playing games, all of those things that I hope would keep us bonded together as a team and focused. I will tell you it's complicated, but I think what is happening now when I think about this hybrid position is we're taking a position that, yes, we can be hybrid. We don't want anyone in our organization to be 100% remote. And there's a couple of reasons for that. One, they get too detached from the culture of the company. And the second reason is we're seeing that there is loneliness, anxiety, and depression in those who do not interact. There's very little substitute for human connection, very little substitute. This is something I'll stand behind. I'm no scientist. I'm not a psychologist, but I will tell you, I've seen time and time again, isolation absolutely never works. I stand behind that. We're asking our teams to create opportunities to interact with, their organizations twice a week, come in for lunch or hit the team meeting in person once a week. So, even if you're in the second thing we're doing is thinking about where are our hubs. And so could we have hubs across the United States so that you come in and you feel the culture and you breathe the culture and you live the culture? Because culture is, it can't sit on a piece of paper like a strategy can. You can't pull it off and then go create an action. It's the way you make someone feel. It's the way the environment looks. And then the last thing I would say about driving culture is to be very, very consistent in aligning your decisions with your culture, mission, and values. You know, there's some great examples of that. You know, for instance, we right now are really stressing the point around the importance of healthcare in this country. And so we've taken a very, very hard stand on why vaccine mandates work. We have delivered 50 million shots in arms across the United States to date, 50 million. And so, and we are adamant about vaccinations. We are a healthcare company. So my my organization at the corporate level has to be 100% vaccinated. I can't have people in the stores, you know, promoting vaccinations and then we're not vaccinated. That doesn't work. So you have to live your culture, your mission and values and be very, very clear about it. Now, can I tell you how much pushback I've gotten about that, right? Because people are being told, people don't like to be told. They think it's a partisan issue. It's not a partisan issue. I take them right back to the definition of a healthcare company and what we're going to stand for in this organization. And so if I didn't do that, they would say, well, that's not, Roz, you're not kind of like, you know, forcing us or allowing us to live our mission and values. And I've been adamant about it. And there's several examples of that, of making sure that your decisions are aligned with what your culture states. And sometimes it's hard because you can say, wow, financially, this is going to kill me. Because, you know, we've got a due date coming of when these vaccinations have to be done. You know, I could have a fallout. I could, there may be some people say, okay, I'm done. I'm leaving the company. And you know what? I have to be prepared for that because I have to stand behind. We have to stand behind as leaders of this organization, what we really mean about providing localized healthcare when it matters and where it matters. And vaccines absolutely are curtailing the spread of this pandemic that we're in.
Yeah, I love that clarity. I think if I have it right, you have something like 400,000 employees worldwide.
Yes.
And I'm interested, so even before we get to the sort of the vaccination requirement and what that's going to do to the workforce, you know, how are you dealing now with just managing talent got harder, you know, that we're in the great resignation or whatever you call it. There's a question from Alexis in Dayton, Ohio, is asking, you know, how are you dealing with the shortage of employees, you know, within the Walgreens Boots Alliance? So talent is it's all stirred up. How are you thinking about talent these days?
Yes, and that is a really big conundrum for us right now. We are seeing it more at our store level, and you know, you may be seeing that in our stores. What we have been doing is to make sure that we do everything we possibly can to retain the current talent that we have. A couple of examples of that, our pharmacists have worked to deliver those 50 million vaccines, those shots in arms. They've been working like mad. And so we wanted to recognize them. So we have adjusted the bonus structure and become, you know, close to, you know, a best in class bonus structure in the pharmacy area. We've looked at minimum wage. So to make sure that we are absolutely offering best in class pay. That we can. But then the other part is making sure that people love where they work. I think the next level that we need to do is to make sure that they have the right job. Some of the jobs now have become very, very complicated. Only imagine working in a Walgreens store where you were the cashier and all you had to do was check people out every day. And that's the job you signed up for. But now you have long lines in the store from vaccines and you have people asking questions. They'll ask the cashier about, you think I should get a third dose? You know, and the cashier is like, how do I direct this question? So we also recognize that they have complicated jobs now. So we said to them, we see that your job is complicated because we're out here in the stores watching, looking, and, you know, trying to help. So we're seeing them, we're hearing them, and then we're trying to simplify their job. So we're putting in new practices, new policies, so these individuals love coming to work every day. And, you know, and sometimes, believe it or not, it is not about pay. It's about, do I love the environment? So we're doing quite a bit of work to say, you're going to have the job that you love. We're going to give you the experience as an employee that makes you want to engage with us as a company. And we realize some are going to step away, right? But then we hope that we can recruit. And we're doing a lot of work right now in terms of recruiting. And I do think that there's going to be a day that people are going to, you know, return to the workplace because this is causing most U.S. companies and even multinationals to rethink who they are as a company. And so I think this is a great time for, you know, a lot of these companies to look at themselves and say, why don't I have a company where people say, okay, it's a tough time, but I want to come to work every day. And so I think this is forcing a better workplace in many of these companies. I just had a chance to talk to a lot of fellow CEOs, and we're all focusing on how do we create the best place to work so that people say, you know, yes, pay me for the work that I do, but make me love my job. Help me love my job.
So, as you said, we're in a transitional moment, and I think that's true. Some of these areas you talk about, but even more broadly, strategically, the social health disruptions have caused a sort of strategic rethink. And you've talked about healthcare and the importance for Walgreens Boots Alliance, but I think you're really undergoing a strategic rethink, and healthcare is at the forefront of that. Could you talk about what you're doing and what that says about healthcare administration, particularly in the U.S.?
Yes. And so what's really happening at WBA is we are looking at the consumerization of healthcare. And it's not unlike the work that I've done when retail went digital and e-commerce came in. This is an opportunity for us to really think about localized healthcare. Healthcare is absolutely local. And if we want to bring access and cost-effective healthcare to local zip codes, Walgreens is prone and primed to do that. We have 9,000 stores across the U.S., and this company has not avoided any zip code in this country. So we are dispersed in the most effective way to localize healthcare. We learned a lot during this vaccine administration. When, first of all, the education of why vaccines matter, we were in the forefront of that to make sure we were educating. But while we were doing that, it helped us realize is that people don't understand their own personal health. And they had been using our pharmacists all along. When they're diagnosed from the physician's office, they grab that prescription. Sometimes they're in a daze, but by the time they get to the pharmacy and the pharmacy says, you have three scripts and this is how this needs to be done, the consultation happens with the pharmacist more so with the physician. And we've been in that position. It was, you know, it was really just forefront for us as we were administering the vaccines. So this work that we're doing now is to help us really be a part of the solution of reducing the cost of healthcare, which means how do we look at absolute costs? And that's about transparency, because a lot of people don't understand what it costs to get treated. So they avoid healthcare, getting care for themselves. And then the second piece is to really get improved outcomes in healthcare. And what's so important is to keep people out of the healthcare system. So once you've been diagnosed and you've got a care plan from your physician, all the monitoring, all the day-to-day keep up, all the consultations that you need with a pharmacist or another practitioner, so that we keep people from returning to the emergency room, because that's when the chronically ill, the most, you know, biggest burden on the cost of healthcare is the chronically ill. And they're returned back and forth through the system because lack of compliance to their meds or whatever the situation may be. So we're creating 1,000 physician-led clinics in our stores through VillageMD, the acquisition we made. And then we're adding 3,000 care centers called health corners, where there's a practitioner, either a pharmacist or a registered nurse. And registered nurses in some states now can write scripts. And so this is a way for you to say, okay, I can't get back to my doctor. I'm feeling poorly today, but here's what I'm dealing with. I'm diabetic, hypertensive. What's happening here? And so your local pharmacy, the beauty of WBA is that we are within 5 miles of 75% of the homes across the U.S. And so if you think that you can go within 5 miles of your home and get some intermediary care, we believe that we can begin to bring the cost of healthcare down.
So we're getting a ton of great questions, of great comments. Roz, if you have a few more minutes, I'd love to get to a couple of those. Excellent.
Yes.
So here's a question from the identity is Fatima from Iran. Her question is, what would be your advice for women who are struggling to work their way up in a male-dominated environment?
Yes. One thing I would say to Fatima, how she enunciates her name, First of all, the one thing about right now trying to understand the workplace is that we're learning one very important thing is the cost of daycare on young families. That may not be the case here, but in many cases, that is keeping women out of the workplace. And I think there are some solutions coming forward around affordable daycare. That's one thing. I would say now, let's say you're in the corporate environment, which I assume you are. I think that first of all, make sure you're clear about what who you are and what you stand for and what excites you, what are your passions. And really, really spend some time thinking about that, doing a personal inventory, because for women, what I see is that they want, because sometimes they're held back, they take the next promotion, but it's not what they really want to do. And then they get to the point where they say, you know what, I really don't want to be in a staff position. I want to be in a P&L position. But you've probably taken promotions in one area and you can't get out of it. You get pigeonholed. So I really encourage women to really do a personal self-evaluation on what you're passionate about and stick to it. Be willing to say no to a promotion. I took 3 sideway positions where I came home and told my husband that I got a new job, and either I took a pay cut or my salary stayed flat. And he wasn't, you know, happy about that. But the learning experience was tremendous. And those were the 3 most impactful positions I could have ever taken. I left Kimberly-Clark as group president and I took a job as vice president at Walmart, but I wanted to learn retail. And I can't come in as a senior VP of retail. I would have been fired the next week because I didn't know what I was doing. But I was willing to take a step down to go much further. And then, you know, that's when my career began to really explode. I was in a learning mode, but I took a step back to get ahead.
That's fascinating. So here's a question from Octavia in Los Angeles. And she's asking, this is a very personal question, as a first generation student in your family, how did your time at Spelman impact your career trajectory?
Yes. So everybody who knows me knows that's the, you know, my deepest love outside of my family is Spelman College, because that experience, that 4 years had such an impact on me, you know, being in an environment where people were studying and learning that looked like me and had similar experiences was very reassuring and reinforcing to me that I could make this happen, because I had 400 other women just like me next to me, you know, doing the same thing. So it was very, very fulfilling. But I would also tell you that there's something about a liberal arts college too. I'm a big supporter of liberal arts institutions. I think that they teach you critical thinking. I was able to do that at Spelman College. So that's what happens, you know, being at an HBCU. And then I would tell you that it's an environment where, you know, the professors and staff and faculty at an institution like Spelman, it's a deliberate choice to teach there. They're absolutely capable to be at, you know, the PWI or the Ivy League schools, but they choose to educate a different kind of student. So the investment was amazing. My senior year, 6 weeks before graduation, going into finals and studying for the GMAT, my dad passed away. And the chemistry department rallied around me and said, you know, go, you know, take care of family, go home. I left for 10 days, came back. They had laid out my, you know, plan for me. I had to take my exams. They made me be accountable, which was really interesting, because believe you me, I was saying, well, can I not like take these and graduate anyway? I've given you 4 years. They were like, no, you've got to take your exams, but we're going to lay out a plan to help you do that. And that was, you know, a good, you know, example of accountability. They were making me stand up for myself. But then they were giving me the opportunity and they laid out a plan. I felt so cared for. I left Spelman on the tip of my toes thinking that I could solve all the world's problems. It wasn't true, but at least they made me feel that way.
That's great. All right. I think we have time for one more question. And, you know, you've been great in really sharing very personal stories. And I want to ask one more personal question. And that's, you know, whether you could share a turning point moment in your professional career that really made you the leader you are today.
Yes. You know, I would tell you probably when I had my first child and I was a young mom trying to stay in the corporate setting. And it was a time where I was being tested. I was working for a gentleman who had already said to me he didn't think that I was smart enough to do the job that I was in. And, you know, and now you're becoming a mom, right? And so that was his thing. It was like, you know, let's think about you doing something else. And I really, that was a turning point for me, because I set out to really prove him wrong that, yes, I am going to be a mom. I'd held off long enough being a mom because of the corporate thing, and I was going to be a mom, and I was going to prove him wrong, and I absolutely did. Eventually, he retired early, and I actually assumed his role. And it took me probably, 18, 24 months to do that. But I think, my leadership showed up, my determination, my steadfastness, but also the appreciation that I was a mom. I didn't hide that I was a mom. I did all the things. I went to daycare and all of those things, but I did what I had to do. And it was a turning point for me. Because I could have easily, at that very point, stayed home, be a stay-at-home mom, and believe what he said to me. And that was a turning point to believe in yourself. Don't believe the hype of someone else that's looking down on you. It charged me, and it still charges me today. And it makes me, think about the young women in my organization. And when they tell me they're expecting, and, you know, I'm like, okay, let's get after it. You know, that's fun. That's what you want. You want people to come work for you that have a fulfilled life. And, we're built around a family structure. So I want people to have a great family life. I don't want anyone ever to be told what they can't do because of what looks like might be an obstacle or, you know, a little break in time to stop them from being effective. I've seen people become actually more deliberate about the work they do because they have to parse out time, right? So I got better on my schedule because, you know, I knew I had to get to daycare to pick up a child, so I had to do 10 things before that. So it was discipline for me, but that changed my life when he said that to me. And I wasn't intentionally pursuing his job. I didn't say to myself, I'm going to put him out of a job. It just happened. I don't know where he is today, but I would, you know, enjoy shaking his hand. I don't know where he is, though.
So, Roz, I want to thank you for being with us today. That was a great conversation. I would love to find a way to do this again or get you back in HBR. So thank you.
That'd be great. Thank you, everyone. I enjoyed it.
All right. So that was Rosalind Brewer, the CEO of Walgreens Boots Alliance. Join us next week when our guest will be Sandy Spiker. She's the CEO of IDEO, the influential design and consulting firm. We're going to talk about design thinking. We're going to talk about design in the future of the workplace. So we'll be airing that live on Monday, December 13th at 12 noon Eastern Time. So thank you all for joining us. This is the New World of Work.